Welcome back, students. As in the previous class, we have studied the Tyndall effect. Now we are going to talk about the Tyndall effect. Tyndall effect. It was named after the scientist who discovered this, and it is very well exhibited by the colloids. Very well exhibited by the colloids. You see this Tyndall effect in your day-to-day life. You might have seen that in a dark room where there is no source of light, and if there is any of a single hole or a small hole left, then you may have seen that light entering into the dark room, and you must have seen the particles of the dust that are roaming up in the pathway of the light. This is the Tyndall effect. Very often, if you have ever visited the forest, and you have seen that in the dense canopy of the forest, among the between the mist of the canopy of the forest, you might have seen that the sunlight passing through the trees. That is the Tyndall effect. Very often you might have seen that sunlight being scattered out through the clouds on the cloudy days. This is again the Tyndall effect. So this Tyndall effect, it is very well exhibited by the colloids. It is the property of the colloids. Now, talking about another thing, that is the component parts of the colloidal solution. Components of colloids. Solution, there were solute and solvent. Here in colloids, there is the dispersion phase and the dispersion medium. It comprises of the dispersed phase, and the second is the dispersion medium. When we are talking about the dispersed phase, we can take it as the solute component of the solution, which is going to be dispersed in the dispersion medium. And dispersion medium, we can take it as the solvent part of the solution, in which the dispersed phase is going to be dispersed. So this is all about the colloids. Now we are going to talk about how these, as we have discussed, the varied type of the mixtures, that is the suspensions, the solutions and the colloids. Now we are going to talk about the separation techniques. Depending upon the type of the mixtures, various separation techniques are used for separating the mixtures. That is, for heterogeneous mixtures, you might have seen that in your day-to-day life, hand-picking method, sieving method, and filtration method, they prove to be very, very useful in separation of mixtures. Then, there are other techniques also which are utilized and are very much beneficial to us in our day-to-day life, and accordingly we are going to talk about these procedures. So the very first thing that we are going to talk about is separation of the colored components, that is your dye, from blue / black ink. Now, in this activity, we are going to separate the component parts of the ink. Component parts means the dye of which the ink is made up of. Basically, ink is a mixture of the dye dissolved in water. So here we are going to put a setup. Here we are taking a beaker This beaker is present on the wire gauge. This wire gauge is resting upon the tripod stand, and here is present the Bunsen burner. We are going to add some amount of water to the beaker, and on this beaker we are going to put a watch glass. On this watch glass we are going to put some amount of ink, few drops of ink. Now we will start heating up the beaker. This beaker, it proves to be a water bath. This is the beaker. This is the wire gauge. This is the tripod stand. Burner. Watch glass. And ink. Here in this setup, this beaker along with the water, it is going to be acting like a water bath, since we cannot heat the ink directly on the flame. Now here what happens, that as soon as we switch on the burner and put on the burner, and as soon as we are going to provide heat to the beaker, the water present in the beaker starts evaporating, and as the water starts boiling, what happens, we will see that in the watch glass some activity is taking place. What is this activity? This activity is evaporation. What happens, as I told you all priorly, the just now in the prior class, that ink is a mixture of the dye which is dissolved in water. So what happens over here, the water which is present as the solvent, it starts evaporating up gradually as heat is being supplied to it through the water bath. Now as and as we are going to continuously provide the heat, the water is going to get evaporated, and after a certain time we are going to observe that whole of the water has evaporated and only some residual particles are left behind. What are these residual particles? These residual particles are the particles or the crystals of the dye of which the ink is made up of. So from this experiment we can say that this procedure is used for separation of the volatile component. Volatile is the water part, from the non-volatile ones, that is the dye. So here we have seen that how we can easily separate the volatile components and the non-volatile components of a solution. Now we are going to study another mechanism or another procedure of separation of mixture, that is very popularly known as centrifugation technique. And it is very well utilized in separation of butter or cream from milk. Not butter, the cream from milk. It is used for separation of cream from milk. Now what happens nowadays in the market, the full toned milk is very easily available, that is full cream milk in which the cream is present. Now what you do, you just start centrifuging it. It is a technique in which a centrifuge is used. Centrifuge is a type of a machine which spins up at a very high speed, and the basic principle behind this rotation is that the particles which are lighter in density, they float up at the surface of the solution, and the denser particles, they settle down at the base of the solution. So here we can easily use the centrifuge. If the centrifuge is not present, we can use the churner, which is very easily available at the home. So what happens when as soon as you start centrifuging this, what will you observe? Centrifuge is this type of machine. The diagram is not given in the book, but as I have used it several times, I will show it to you. This is a centrifuge, and as we open up the lid, there are certain holes that are made up over here, and in these holes we put in the test tubes like this. The test tubes are placed like this, and these test tubes are containing the mixtures that we want to separate out, and then it starts rotating at a very fast rate. The rotations are counted as RPM. RPM means rotations per minute. All these things are not given in your NCERT, and that is not required also. That is only for your knowledge. Now, as soon as you start churning up, or as soon as you start centrifuging it up, what happens that the denser particles, they start settling down, and the lighter one particles, they come up at the surface of the solution, and you can very easily separate out through your hands or by any other technique. This technique is very well utilized in separating the solutions in which the particles are so small enough that they can be very easily filtered. So to avoid such type of conditions, we use the centrifugation technique. Now talking about the applications, where are the centrifugation techniques utilized? When we are talking about the applications of this technique is very well utilized in the medical laboratories or diagnostic centers to separate out the components of blood and urine. Secondly, it is used in separation of cream from milk in the dairies. And the third is that it is very often used in drying up your clothes when you are spinning it up at a very high speed in the washing machine. So we have studied about the two techniques. In the next class, we are going to talk about the other techniques which are useful in separation of different type of mixtures. Thank you.